fat dynamite.
Good evening. I want to thank everybody that came out for coming to the fourth. Yes, this is our fourth writer of this year's River City Writer Series. Tonight we have Eve Shelnutt. I want to remind you all that Stephen Dobbins will be coming in March. I think it's the 6th. I'm not sure about that, though. Watch out.
Third and fourth.
Thank you. And Sophia Henderson Holmes will be coming in April. So I'm going to turn this over to Cynthia Armes to introduce Ms. Shelnutt. But we're having a reception at Carrie Hillis's after the reading. There are maps, as usual, by the front door. Please come. Please bring whatever it is you want to drink. Please bring whatever it is you want to eat. And we'll have a great time.
Good evening. Eve Shelnutt's passion for the creation of literature has led her to pursue a rather diversified writing career. She is a poet, an essayist, a fiction writer, a creative writing theorist, and a teacher. For over 18 years, she has been part of the American Writing Program. First as a student at the University of Cincinnati, then at the University of North Carolina, under the guidance of Fred Chappell, and then as a teacher. She has taught at Ohio University, Goddard College, and Western Michigan University. Currently, she teaches creative writing at the College of Holy Cross in Worcester, Massachusetts. As a teacher and critical writing theorist, Ms. Shelnutt has published several critical essays advocating a formal pedagogy of teaching creative writing, more conducive to the critical inquiry of fiction and form. Young writers, she believes, need to move beyond the reiteration of literature toward the creation of literature. Ms. Shelnutt's creative writing textbooks demonstrate the formal methods that she advocates. The Writing Room, The Keys to the Crafts of Fiction and Poetry, Writing the Translation of Memory, The Magic Pencil, Teaching Children Creative Writing. Ms. Shelnutt's passion to teach the next generation of writers to create literature led her to develop a week-long summer seminar at the College of Holy Cross to train high school teachers to teach creative writing in Massachusetts public schools. As a poet and fiction writer, Ms. Shelnutt has published 3 volumes of poetry. Her recent collection is entitled First, A Long Hesitation. 5 collections of short stories, including her latest collection, The Girl Painted. Her stories have been represented in anthologies, including the O. Henry Prize stories and Pushcart Prize anthology. In addition, Ms. Shelnutt has edited 2 collections of short stories and critical essays, The Confidence Woman, 26 Women Writers at Work, The Poor Elephant, 27 Male Writers at Work. Ms. Shelnutt believes that fiction can still change us, shake us to our roots. Indeed, her own fiction illustrates the complexity of her material, language, and form. Her fiction requires a close reading, as good fiction should. Tonight, Ms. Shelnutt will read to us some poetry from one of her collections, Recital in a Private Home, and other collections. She will also read Distance from the Girl Painted. Please welcome Ms. Eve Shelnutt.
Time here. I don't want to go on the rest of this reading tour. I'll just stay here. I can't see that anything else will match it. I've been very impressed by the program and by the students. It's really quite rewarding. At Holy Cross, I'm not teaching graduate students at this time because we don't have any graduate students at Holy Cross. And I got sort of nostalgic for graduate students. I'll have to do something about that at some point. So I want to thank all of you. The arrangements have been flawless. right, you should think of that. The food is terrific. No one's stolen my car because it's parked in the garage. So, and my son and daughter-in-law drove over from Oxford, which just thrilled me. And so I'm very happy tonight. However, my writing's all dark, so we'll move on. I'm going to start with a few poems. This is from, I should read a southern poem if I have it in here. I think I remember this one. But this, I hadn't been in the South for a long time, and I was, I drove into Greensboro, I was supposed to show up at school and register, and I heard one of these preachers on the radio selling something called prayer cloth, which you could buy by the inch to cover various ailments, and I was so struck by the fact that I truly was back in the South. This is called Taking Brother Mabry's Cure. After listening to the radio in the car, I ordered myself some prayer cloth so wide it will take two to lay them on, somewhere left of the angina and to the right of the sugar diabetes. Not that I'm afflicted, Lord. It ain't the pain that counts, he said. It's the laying on of hands, and I believed. So an incidental poem. This one is sort of an incidental poem, too. I was sitting in a fish house eating fish, reading, whatever lumber paper they had. And I happened on the want ads, and there was one of those personal columns, and there was this poor man of 70 seeking a partner of 70. So I started thinking about that. This is called Answering. If you write for company, why limit yourself to women of 70? In my bedroom is a faded rug, rose patterned, pictures of my great-grandmother line the bureau, and I grow more like her daily. A rocker could be set rocking. We could undress by candlelight or kerosene, wick trimmed close, the odor of sulfa binding the quilts. As for me, I do not like taut skin. A man once showed me how the leopard's rides loosely over his muscles and why. Although I need not tell you of countries other than our own, how she is exhausted climbing from the wagon, so much of herself left littering the dry plains when axles broke, and how, when he offers his hand, she does not think of age, her children left beside stones. Nor will she name them, as if tapping her heart three times to get it going. It beats a code which only the novice cannot read, as if smoke were merely smoke instead of news. And he does this. He builds a fire of twigs and helps her bathe, riding the cloth gently, wraps her in coarse blankets bartered by those whose time also is ending. He may hum a song, for she likes words still and watchful. Listen, and do you see how she smiles? A small animal, half asleep in his lap, absently nuzzling her open hand. Another one from recital in a private home. This one, I mentioned in the interview today that I use a lot of images from the Nazi era, predominantly because when I was very young, my mother, who had been so struck by both the dropping of the bombs on Nagasaki and Hiroshima and by the discovery of the opening of the concentration camps by the Allied troops, and what both of those events implied about a changed world. And she used to say to us as children, you have no idea what life was like before. And that did something to our imaginations, but it also, I think, made at least me and the three children find out what she was talking about. And, this is called At the Mass Graveyard. The dead have no doubt that something overwhelming has happened. They disclose a sort of detachment, consuming oblivion. If they talk, surely it is of weight. Leaves, moss, myrtle, white violets, stones. To carve a branch breaking over stone is to lighten them, yet for us, the branch is endlessly breaking. There is no wretchedness like fogged men. But why speak of wounds? The dead wear no stigmata. In this whole plane, there is no blood, only our memories of their discarded arms, the trains rumbling, each like the tooth of a rake. Here and there, a child is held up to the narrow opening, a little blue enamel mug dancing with every jolt. And I'll read a few poems from Personal Hesitation. I wrote this book, as I wrote many things, because I was somewhere, I guess at a party, and someone said blithely, "Oh, no one can write a book of love poems anymore," meaning the world had changed too much for such a folly as that. So I proceeded to write a book of love poems. And it was the most interesting experience. The reviewers astonished me. Some of them didn't quite recognize it as a collection of love poems, and they found it as, I think it was in the New York Times book review, somebody astonished that there was so much eroticism in these poems. My goodness. This doesn't happen to be one of those poems, but I can read some. And as I have spoken of today, I don't write particularly autobiographically in the particular, which gives y'all kind of freedom. This is titled, "O Hero." His was a house in which the father drank, so the boy came to have a claim over peaches, not merely those falling bruised and ready from trees planted at his birth, but over all the wine not yet made in tomorrow's buzzing, the knotted cry. Sunlight at certain hours inflates the downy breasts of peaches. Some orchards from a distance appear as mounds of children bored with the game of death. Patience lies fallow at harvest. Sweet vapors rise from the pickers' bodies dense with heat. No matter how much they eat, baskets overflow, juice running between wire slats as though in expiation, without anger, love. The pits are mute, dazed by a light or a smile of joy. In winter, what then? When the dead draw into anguish and the living think only of money, masking their loneliness, what then? He turned away from this friendly curiosity, and we, who could find no other outlet for our energy, waited by the fire, studying our suspect hands. And I'll read a three-part poem called "The Adulteress." The point of my mentioning this is not my grandmother. But you see, you get to live all of these different lives and commit all of these different sins. I mean, this is part of the problem. The Adulteress 1. He let me sleep in a wooden house by the sea, light flowing like water in a gutter along the hall. The smell of salt, screech of birds crying shame, were meant to purge my blood. But my husband waited like a saint with broken legs, who knows rebuke can be a kiss, a scent of jasmine, the shiver of twigs along a path. Nights I saw you gesture at the sky, your mouth opened as though you were shouting. The gray sky lightened, weak and exhausted as wind blew on the tiny flame of sun. Where had it begun against common sense? The air was silk, swelling, and you began to speak our language, unsated thought, slowly. I held to the rim of the sea with each stroke feeling a wave of faintness and my heart's knocking. No, I will never return to water. Yes, my eyes are open like a fish who has relinquished hope. And is this love what you wanted? The strangeness of it with me forever, my husband struggling each morning to walk. 2. Because we love one another, the dead enter our room, crowding like cattle around a trough of hay. Always they assemble to our breathing. Even their bells are still as I say your name. A small town on the precious Slavic plain, gone, gone, the night of the giraffe. Faded silk, glowing hair, the reflections of a shadow. Tolerant of innumerable treacheries, they did not want to have memory killed, pangs of consciousness taken away. It is good of them to have come, our room having been viewed already and forgotten, our riches, not our crimes, stirring them to awe. And the third section. I am careful with your name taken from our room among strangers, those good, illiterate women, with little girls hidden inside them lacking pleasures they will not admit, or men whose painful concentration shows only in the act of love. I feel they will hear nostalgia in it, but for that there is no word, always the same, stretched across the horizon. Once I saw a boy tie the legs and tail of a mosquito, letting it settle on him in peace. The point of view, local, precise. Evening, the hour of the mosquito. In a million years, the boy will explain everything. His eyes, a bare esplanade of tranquility. So clemency comes with the silent witness of images. Tonight, I sat among others for a long time without talking, and at first my silence puzzled them, a fish who has swallowed the river. Then they heard water closing over your body, someone swimming in darkness. What was he waiting for? Why didn't he take her away? I will never read a rather long story, but it's what I want to read, so I get to read it. The characters, the title of the story is Distance, as you mentioned. The characters are the narrator, who was a young woman, who was married to an older man who has died at the time of the story. And the story is the young woman's lover. And then a set of aunts, the mother, the daughter's mother's sisters, and their husbands are in the story, and the main character, a boy of seven. Oh, I do want to read the epigraph of the whole book, because in fact it's the word distance in the epigraph that caused me to write the story, because I put that on the page as a title. It is an epigraph from Josephine Jacobson's poem, Destinies. How do I know then that over the terrible distance where you are, I must arrive? The point is established, but the how is not established at all. And that's the epigraph for the whole collection. Distance. Already, someone will have put him on the train in northern Iowa, the boy who will remember to buy the flowers. And there, it didn't rain unexpectedly, drops falling as fast as wishes from a gray painted sky. Someone would have fed him something warm. Person old enough to have a vision of his narrow face pasted to the window, and miles of grass bent flat by wind, dry wind almost silver through grasses never reflecting the sky. The note pinned to his shirt pocket gives him away, not because he is not beautiful or bright enough. All boys at that age are beautiful from pride and the urge to run away. It brightens their eyes, even when they keep them calm and hooded. Simply, in a scrawl on blue, you can have him, He was not really mine anyway. What does that mean? And who instructed him carefully about the flowers, fixed the oatmeal so that he would travel on its warmth, let him pet the cats a final time, and did not want him to cry? From the platform, she must have seen the thin, pale stalk of his neck jutting just above the train's window, maybe only that, the shade half drawn, saw the muscles of the neck push his head back against, almost into the seat, his eyes looking straight ahead, as if he imagined he would die and, like a bird or a flower, didn't know to ask for mercy. Then the train moved once, held back, moved, a jerking, accumulating, a connotation for the word train, as her smell would have connoted for him mother or woman or whatever she was to him. He should have gotten off then, but his pride was of the opposite sort, not to have her face grow wild when it was now set. She must have seemed fragile, something showing on her without precedent in his life that held him back, or everything he had seen being around her coalescing at once. And a boy's body does not call what it does a revelation. It moves or it stays put, implicated in some unnameable embrace, feral. He must think that he leaves for her, her sake, for some mysterious life that has only been suggested, a raggedness of movement. It wasn't there now. He looked once. Suppose he relaxed, alone, but for a small tinted flame, interior. Or maybe the note in his pocket was more normal, whatever that may mean in the context of sending a boy to live with strangers. He had lost the note or letter by the time he got to Kalamazoo, read it and thrown it away, read it and held it in one hand. Not for the word's comfort, but for being simply something of her, held it until it crumpled from his swim. Maybe even then, when he was 8, she was partially educated, readers say of William Blake by some accident, and was propelled to explain as evenly as possible. He's mine, but you know that. And because he, at least, has done nothing disgraceful, I trust you will take him in before I taint him in some way by teaching him my fears. Sitting at the kitchen table, the only table, where she wrote the note, single bulb hanging over it, creating, if she could have known, standing back observing, a lovely picture, she might have listed to herself what seemed like a plethora of fears and shivered. Well, they included almost everything in the modern world, did they not? He slept then in the next room, blissfully unaware. She was certain that his intelligence, what she thought it indicated of his potential, was far greater than hers. His father is much older than I, and died soon after the birth. He has been around a few men, but how, still going to school as I am, would I meet men like your husbands to bring home? In fact, her men were usually musicians, or at least young men who played musical instruments, Spanish guitar, flute, mandolin, music a kind of promontory leading to her. It got to her in some way she was ashamed of. They were like artist princes, drifting, pretending. He is almost old enough to see it all. See what? If this is what the boy read, what would he understand of the phrases? It was comprehensive, what she said. Reading it, he may have felt exhilarated by its opacity, something to discover later. For seconds, even for minutes, he would have felt older, more capable, and sat up straighter in the seat, noticing the nubby brown of the train's seat covers, how faded the sun had made the green window shade. During the first day of his travel, after driving home alone, she would have arranged the cans in the kitchen shelves to keep herself from running outside in a frenzy of panic, which, having imagined it hundreds of times when she had thought he was in danger, her body had memorized as proper response. To let go voluntarily the boy for whom she would have killed, I have thought of it many times, and I have decided that I want him to have what all of you can offer him now before it's too late. And the conductor knew he was on the train, both decent-looking men, and an older woman whose job it was to rent pillows until 9:15, when the train pulled up next to a closed depot and let her out to meet a man in a beige truck that was parked near the tracks. Asking for special treatment since he was so young, she had lied, saying she herself had no money for a ticket, that much was true. Only enough for the boy, whose father, much older than she, it had been true, lay dying in a veterans hospital in Kalamazoo, Michigan, where there was such a hospital, and he was asking to see the boy a final time. Did the boy hear this lie about his father and ride then with an image of him under sheets, waiting, faceless, inert? And what could they say but disapprovingly, yes? And the boy's father had seen the boy then soon after, falling, breaking bones in his rib cage and hips, and died soon after, when she had convinced herself that he was invincible because he had wanted to be. But he had been in no war, there was no pension, the tiny house was rented. She had the car, she had her help, and she had a confidence in fate now. Sometimes, when he was still very small, she had looked at the boy, puzzled, as if trying to remember how she'd come to have him, the new unnaturalness of a child with no family. And that is my point. I am not by myself a family. I see that now, or I've seen it all along, and I'm now acting on it. He, the husband, would have stopped her. And that, for all of the boy's seventh year, had been the stupefying part. Her husband's voice seemed to say, but we can work this out. We're not incapable people, you know. It ran, his voice, like a tape recorder through her head, and only lately had she begun to argue back. You aren't here, or softly, you are here. Simply, seriously, each time more quietly, which meant that daily the boy was in more danger of being sent away. The cat slept in his room on a little blanket in a corner, his cat, the other one being hers, now both hers. He may have thought to himself, but skeptically, since he did not believe an animal could be so simply handed over. If he had had the thought, it was a prophecy, except that someone was worse a prophecy, or it remains dormant, simply a fate whose time is coming. She, his mother, had he known what a shared thought, however differently worded, had drawn them together, cemented them? She, his mother, had thought whenever she read that all words were prophecy, announcements that kept fate tamed, quiet, coming softly on thin yellow legs. How many times before he died had Blake set his own death, and how many ways? On the afternoon of the day the boy departed, it began to rain, the serious rain of fall with its promise of cold, but not nearly there, the kind of cold the boy was headed towards, Michigan snow, sleet, wind, blueness of a sky brittle with cold. Then she had gone out driving around aimlessly until parking to watch a bike race. The racers, one of whom she knew, going over a hill, disappearing, then reappearing so quickly that it made nothing of the road she and he often walked. Watching him fly past four times, she knew she was through with him. Or she imagined she was until that night when she let him in, whimpering almost as soon as he had closed the door. The boy, upon boarding the train, had put his off-white canvas bag on the seat beside him. It contained his food, as well as the clothes, a few books, she thought he would be calm enough to read. His body appeared calm. It was a trait he had learned while watching her. She stopped, shook her shoulders, looked around slowly, breathed in, and opened wide the fingers of each hand, even if he happened to be holding her right hand. His would fall, her fingers spreading. With her was anything natural. Opening the door that evening, her lover still in his biking clothes, the one that seemed to shrink him, making him look too young, too small to make love to anyone, she felt she was in two places at once, inside herself, needing him before she broke from the pain kept slightly aside all day, like something parallel and too familiar to need looking at. But also, she seemed to stand back, observing herself, opening the door and, as a whimper bubbled up, throwing herself at him, a traveling back and forth of herself, even a third position, herself coolly thinking, considering it pathetic, her gestures of remorse that had taken into account his arrival, the open door, the rain on his jacket, the wind blowing her blue stationery from the table, where two cans she hadn't known where to put in the cabinets were sitting. She wished now he hadn't come, a wish she was free to have now that he had. A promise, in fact, extracted from him 2 days before when she had begun to imagine the scene at the train. Not her feelings, only the picture of the boy in one place, herself in another, and a white, blank space behind her, a precipice, until she filled it imaginatively with her house and some activity in it. Well, he could stay. Why not? Whatever transpired between them beside the point. She knew now, motion would have this edge to be gone through only as if to get to the other side. Each action accompanied by a sensation of restlessness for real life to begin again. Ah, so this was the difference between what death ended and choice ended. The boy and she still had volition, still occupied space pushing forward with them encased in little envelopes of time. Her son might reappear at any moment. The possibility had a kind of logic to it, despite the quite clear instructions. He should be raised as if all of you are his parents. He will grow up feeling doubly lucky, and he will forget eventually, since he's so young. So obviously, given the contradictions of her thought, she hadn't considered everything. Her biker took off his windbreaker and shook it when she sat on the edge of a chair. He should have gone with me to the train station. But I was in training all day, which she pictured, a blur, a smear of bike and person, while it seemed they, she and the boy, stood motionless. Still, it would have made a difference in what he saw, since you encouraged it. Are you sure he's sleeping? And shh, he'll hear you. I didn't encourage it. It was when I felt the most dangerous, you know, when you said something and I agreed in some way, even when I didn't say anything. And how true of the thought, she thought, and she was aware, too, of what they said, filling the room in the way she had anticipated its being filled when she had made him promise to come, regardless of how tired the afternoon race had made it. So, she had gotten what she had asked for. And later, after whatever explosion of feeling was gotten through between now and then, something building in her indictment and in how casually he answered her, and the disjunction between their two states, they would make love because so late there would be little to do, or because so late for her to refuse would incite another panic, distracting her. Left uninstructed, the boy would have eaten all of the food in the brown paper bag inside the canvas an activity, since the books inside the canvas bag seemed to have no relationship to him, simply there on one side of his clothes, unrecognizable almost. But she had stooped in front of him twice, once in the kitchen before leaving, and after she had locked the car doors at the station. both times she had taken his narrow face between her hands and recited the rules for the trip, and far beyond into the limitlessness of his entrustment to someone other than herself, waiting between each for it to enter his head, wedded to the steadiness of her eyes looking directly into his. She had learned this gesture from her husband, his hands taking hers over the white sheet, his eyes uncommonly clear. Promise me you'll do something with yourself, whatever it meant. The tone and substance, brave and meant to impart a kind of serene will inside her that could function as a benediction. And much later, she would compare those occasions, her husband's and hers with the boy, to what she had learned of the way children, especially children, were given no similar opportunity to receive instructions at Buchenwald, Auschwitz, or for that matter, anywhere events disallowed calm, final instructions, even if the words themselves were not applicable. The boy drank the orange juice, then the two bottles of the apple juice, afterwards carefully zipping the bag closed, with the bottles restored in the space he had taken them from, and a slowness of order uncommon for him. Now the grass in the moving field outside the window was almost invisible, then suddenly gone as the light above each window of the compartment came on. He saw that his face and the face of the old woman across the aisle was reflected in the glass, unless he leaned forward and put his face flat against the window. Then in the distance, farmhouses came and went with their barns, and the lights shining from tall poles making visible the fences and the moving shapes of penned animals. He slept, or his legs hanging unsupported halfway to the floor numbed and drew the rest of him into semi-sleep, his clean hands open to form a shallow cup on his navy cotton pants. This may have been the picture of him she had had, beyond mentioning, since it was for herself and not for him, a steady moving forward. Already, one aunt, having driven with her husband across town to be with the other, the two were inspecting a final time the room that was to be the boy's. Not his mother's sister's, but her mother's, the one who had died leaving this mess, which their capabilities, she must have counted on it, would fix. And the room was anything anyone could want, put together with the dredged up impulses and images from the long past era of their fertility, when they, not for heaven's sakes the niece at age 16, should have had their children. And now these rays of love, directed so long in the controlled ways of women who love without children having submitted them to their husbands, seemed to the upkeep of their bodies and the small rituals of couples with enough money to back them up, to support these thousand acts of maintenance. They switched off the light and joined the men for whom so much had been considered and inserted into time so that it would pass well. All four would go, of course, to meet the boy, although anything could have happened on the way, which the aunts kept unspoken. Possibly a fear leaked out in their movements, too bustling. But their movements would not be a betrayal of fear unless the other one or one of their husbands mentioned it. And they were careful people. It was what, in her mind, had recommended them to the mother. Having been in their homes once briefly when she was 15, the fathers, both the boys' mothers and the boys, well, one disaster led straight to another, did it not? Unless someone with the conception of order intervened, providing space for thought, an atmosphere conducive to thought. Possibly the aunts considered climate a factor. And here the pristine days of winter were coming, to be deliberately arranged into seasons, rituals, colors, even something so simple as giving the boy hot chocolate after he came in from sledding with his friends. My trouble, the mother may have written in the note that would disappear during the trip, is the feeling of not experiencing his childhood. And I think it must feel the same to him, as if he's been living simply adjacent to me when I'm unable to spend what must be the necessary time, time slowed down, to look into his life, not only mine, happening now. I can't seem to inhabit him and keep seeing him as both mine and not mine. If he isn't standing next to me, I think about what I should do, should be doing, have done, and haven't done to recognize his life. Every thought seems self-conscious, almost unnatural, as if the way I go about thinking prevents any possibility of what the thought is for ever coming to fruition. And this awkwardness only disappears when he's with me, next to me, in the car, or on a walk, for instance. But maybe these were only sentences she had thought. Possibly other words framed her thoughts, words that in daily exchanges with the boy would have been communicated to him somehow, to make his rights as a child seem paramount to her, even if she were day by day accruing reasons to give them away. Either these words in a letter or similar statements conveyed as they did things together, the effect of them would have been to give him something while simultaneously drawing it away into her, the giver. Attention. Not a strain of feeling, but an irresoluteness. Possibly it made him feel careful, almost as if he had been sick sometime earlier. At 9, the women with the pillows had passed through what was the train's last occupied car, and making no rental, had gone through the vacuum-operated door, turning back to look at its two passengers, wondering why the boy had been put there, away from the others. But maybe the old woman was the boy's grandmother, too old to be trusted, on a separate seat to give him sleeping room. Having had the three bottles of juice, now he had to find the bathroom, and he walked, holding on tightly each time he moved forward to the next car, half full, and threw it to the next, where men sat drinking and playing cards. Making love that night, what she had felt was the razor musician's insubstantiality. Although he was, as he always was, exactly the same, no more or less, attentive, considerate, the same in every way. Only now, in bed with him for the first time, when he would not need to leave at dawn so as not to give a wrong impression to the boy, now she felt as if her back, her spine, were exposed to the door, to the possibility of its being opened by some thief or murderer or bomb, when never once while the boy slept to the next room did she imagine the possibility after locking the door for the night. The pile of clothes on the floor seemed insubstantial, hers dwarfing his, not because she was larger, but because he wore so little, as if he never looked at them to find them ridiculous. It could be that then she closed off from him, no matter that she rested her head on his shoulder with one hand between her legs made wet by him. Not separated from him in such a way as to see him through some thin sheath of protection like a frozen lake until another desire, another nature in herself asserted itself like a warming. Simply because she wouldn't give him up easily, she felt older than he, although chronologically at age 27, he was 3 years beyond her. Her sudden dislike startled her. His name, Jean. She would rather have said Eugene as a way to give him weight, if that were possible. And all of this, too, was a distraction, a way of reinserting herself into some racket of ordinariness by which the radical nature of the morning would subside through noise. The train's bathroom was nothing like her description. She had said it would be similar to those on Greyhound buses, which they rode every year when going to put flowers on the grave of the man who had been, she said, his father. This was a small room separated from the card players by two doors and a small hallway with a red light inside a dome fixed above the second door. Inside were seats in a row under the window. A man sat on one, sleeping, snoring, with his mouth open, his hands over his stomach, partially exposed because his pants were unzipped and the shirt partially pulled out. When he finished, he zipped his pants inside the cubicle and was washing his hands as she had reminded him to, the man woke up or had been awake. He noticed it and almost jumped back when he reached up for the paper towels. The man wasn't moving, only winking at him. First one eye, then the other. His mother had been wrong about the room, and had also said nothing about a car with tables and a set of machines for crackers or men drinking in the car with paper cups. He had to step around the man's feet to put the wet towel in the bin, and now, when he stepped around him again and began pushing the door open, it slammed open, seeming to fly from his hands as if accidentally he had pushed it too hard when it had seemed heavy. Then he was being lifted up by one arm, lifted and twisted around in one motion to the man's face. "Is this what we've got?" slamming the boy back against the wall opposite the open door. "Well, keep it." He put his fingers on the boy's cheeks, pressing until his lips formed a pucker. "God, oh, what?" dropping the boy and slamming the second door behind him. So now, having waited and then walked with his head down through the compartment of tables to his own car, he sat breathing steadily, one short breath deliberately followed by another until his chest began to feel normally tight. He knew now that he would not eat or drink more of what she packed, would not leave his seat until he arrived. She had been wrong about the bathroom, she had known about the car with the tables, and he couldn't fall asleep since the woman was asleep and too old to help him if she were awake. Help him how? Against what? It was what he didn't know, what she hadn't imagined, except that he was not to talk to strangers, and he had obeyed. When he was asleep, he cried to himself, except when he brought his shirt tail out to wipe his face, and then stuffed it back in, he saw that he hadn't been asleep, had been pretending with his eyes almost closed. Because he couldn't sleep now. Now it wasn't allowed. She said upon waking that he was almost there and soon she would be able to call. Not to talk to him, as she had explained, now it wouldn't be good to talk since he would make a new life there, going, oh, to drawing lessons at the art center, a brochure had advertised them. Its work with young children was specialty of the museum, and of course the school and to the park across the museum and other things boys did. Whatever, too, the aunt's husbands thought to take him to, having to do with sports, which I've neglected for you. But the aunts or one of them would say he had arrived. He's right here beside me. And then life would begin again. She would be in her classes in order to resume removing what had been her husband's superiority and knowledge that had made her envy him, given her the sense that it was the one thing to possess now that he was gone. Some guarantee against anything whole being wholly ruined again, a corner to turn. In class, she approached it hopefully full of a kind of faith that was inexplicable, except in how she had absorbed his final words when he had been cool and nevertheless caressive and had caused an ache between her legs. And her memories not much changed, but driven inward. It was the aunts who noticed the beauty of the morning, its light made more brilliant by the clearness of the sky seemingly purified by a sudden drop overnight in temperature. Light pouring into the windows in what was to be the boy's room, which the aunt in whose house the room was located described by phone to the one across town, also restless until the train was next. But none of them was free to see the day apart from its meaning to them, the weather's pragmatic registering on them, except possibly the boy. Not the mother, since Jean or Eugene was still there, a new event requiring accommodation around her inward focus, but seamlessly because she felt or thought she should feel some gratitude, and because it would be only later that she sent him away, got rid of him, extracted him from her life, from his, to whatever extent the two had meshed. The boy had watched all night what life there was, and verily, when it was still pale, had moved slowly, pulling one leg up to take his left sock off and remove the money she'd given him for the flowers. He put it in his shirt pocket where the note had been, and he sat still again, waiting, While the scenery changed to include towns and all that went with them, the trains slowing, sometimes coming to a full stop and picking up speed again as the sky lightened. She must have asked about the flower seller, called and known and told him what was true even then. The woman came through after one of the trains stopped, so he was able to buy the carnations, 6 of them, 3 for each aunt, as she had said, since she had not wanted him to know that without them, how would the aunts know who he was? He tore the thin green paper wrapped around them into half and wrapped both sets of 3 into separate squares of paper, his own decision, and held them together in one hand. When she called, it was from the payphone because she didn't have a phone in the house. She chose the one inside the drugstore with its door and little fan, which she cut off in order to hear better. "He's here," the aunt said flatly. And she waited for more, listening to her aunt's breathing. Then, "What do you want? He's here. We agreed. He's here." So she had promised in her note or by telephone when making the arrangements. And to herself, a sub-vocalization within a litany of promises. She wasn't to talk to him. What did she want now? A description? And so she wasn't to hear that the boy, standing on the metal steps of the train and while climbing down with his canvas bag in one hand, the carnations in the other, a porter waiting at the foot of the steps, that he had begun to wet himself and that it had streamed down the inside of his pants, that he had begun to cry when he felt it, and that he hadn't been able to stop himself from crying, even when the aunts rushed up crying, "Baby, hush, hush, it's all right, everything's all right. You're fine, you'll be fine now, you did just fine, it's all right," over and over. The husbands were standing back, taking the bag and the flowers, and then taking out their cigarettes while their wives talked to the boy, smoothed his hair, got a sweater from the canvas bag, and put it on him. And she wasn't to know that in the red car, both aunts and Ed, the uncles and the other, him and the front, one aunt behind on the back seat, that they began, between pointing out to him all there was to do in Kalamazoo, began to talk about her, the mother, or whatever she was to him now. Somehow they saw it in what the trip had been like, saw, he imagined, even the man in the bathroom, what it may have meant, and couldn't say, not to him, but over him, enough about a disgrace that such a trip had been for someone so young. Its inconceivability in an unsafe world, its typicality as a scheme from the atypical part of the family, how anything at all might have happened when he was precious, truly beautiful, and quiet and obviously intelligent to have remembered the flowers, surprising though it was then, it was that she had any money to give him for them. It seemed to animate them, excite them, to say what might have gone wrong, to imagine all she had not imagined, and then to recite his state not minutes before. While he, in order to listen without their realizing he was listening, turned around in his seat to look at the town where he would live. So straight, so soon, so fast, before his memories and hers changed. In bed, after his hot chocolate with the stuffed bear beside him given by one of the uncles, as he watched the light through the shade, he began to sense an unfairness, or at least something wrong, or something slipping away as if it were finished like a train's view. Or it was a stubbornness he may have felt many times before with her over some small thing, rising now, here, but with her connected, greeting him, not against her, but with her attached, an almost hot sensation of pleasure each time it came when he turned in the covers. It was a kind of travel unknown to the aunts or to the two uncles or the cousin. It wasn't her fault, the sentence he managed, and the sentence that impregnated him, a weighing against what was her fault, the description of the bathroom, for instance. And over several weeks, they began to feel, because the aunts talked on the phone and went over and over again for the signs of difference and neglect, pure youth and breeding and waywardness and no doubt sexuality and choices connected to it. He began to feel a sifting through of truth from distortion, as if a drape covered one and like a piece of clothing encased next to him. She went around carefully and moving carefully as though she had been released from a hospital and could not be sure of the sharpness of alien objects, of the place wherein she moved. "I know I will miss him," she may have written in her note, "but that will be my concern," which it was. But more than what may have been the life accounting of it in the note had prepared her for. And beautifully he went to the new school and brought from a boy to play with, and he ate what the aunts provided, waiting but uncertain for what. A redress of an imbalance? But how would it come now? And they never said her name now, mentioned her at all now. She had talked about his father often, a shadow brought to the table when they ate or went walking, or as he grew when similarities between them began to be apparent to her where the memory rested. To her teachers who asked, to the man at the meat counter where she shopped, to a neighbor, even to Jean, she brought him out, explaining where he was and why. But how many times could she do that, sucking from a bare fact a repeated need for its repetition? She let his room stay as it was, and this too was one of the differences. Death demanded a disposing, because the face came up even in objects to admonish, still looking at me. When it had been a husband, somehow sexual and thus indecent. But this, maybe the boy's things were like ornaments. Did he return? Suppose, using all of his intelligence, he got back. Having stolen the ticket money from one of the uncles, then, from what he remembered of the note, something he had learned from it, knew how to say what a ticket master or a conductor would require. And coming flowerless, found her several weeks later, drinking coffee alone in a cafe in town in the afternoon between her classes. Oh, their mutual panting after a second disbelief, their walking together in a purer uniting than birth, then each explaining at once, the words colliding, how they had not been separated at all, not at all. And then the red was laughing, holding on, laughing, because between them they had outmaneuvered the world this time and hence forever. My God, you could hear it, everyone turning to watch how they outshine everything. Whose business then would it be? When they're seen taking their walks, or much later buying him a first suit or brown shoes, or picking out a second cat to replace the one that ran away? Whose business is it now? To anyone taking the time to watch, to evaluate, they appear uncommonly close, that in their smallest sentences and manners and inaction and silences, then almost perceptible, some suggestion of death or its surrogate hangs about them. And for the young, for the uninitiated, makes them as a pair and sometimes individually hard to look at, hard to love.
Do you have any questions you want to ask, or shall we just go
maps by the front door if they're not all gone. This place is on Central, but you can't park in our parking lot, so you have to park. Not Central, not this was on Highland. Excuse me, but you have to park across the street from the apartment building.
Did you come today? Did you see this?
I assume that it'll be self-explanatory.